West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy with Chef Justice Putnam. NetRootsRadio.com.
Je voudrais du soleil vert, des dentelles et des théières, des photos de bord de mer, d'un mangeadin d'hiver. Je voudrais de la lumière, comme en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Je veux changer d'atmosphère, d'un mangeadin d'hiver. Je voudrais du Fred Astaire, revoir un latte
coé. I know what you're thinking. Now, if all of this sounds familiar, that's because it is exactly what Trump and his cronies tried to do in the 2020 election. So although national races tend to steal the spotlight, yes, we get that, these state-level wins are important, and they will have major implications, not only on policy, like abortion rights and legislation, but also for the foundation and the future of our democracy. Let's bring in someone who knows the ins and outs of the state-level politics, Ben Wickler. He's the chairman of the Wisconsin Democratic Party. Also joining us is Molly Jung-Fast, host of the Fast Politics podcast. It's great to have both of you with us. Molly, I'll start with you. Your reaction to the Democrats not just holding the Senate majority, as I outlined, which is extremely important and very significant, but what they were able to do on a state level.
I think that the we in the pundit class did not give the American voters enough credit, right? I mean, they rejected authoritarianism, they rejected Trumpism, they rejected racism and division, and they voted for the, you know, the good guys won democracy. You know, these swing state, these swing state candidates who are anti-democratic, election deniers, almost all of them have lost. We still have another gubernatorial that's waiting to be called. But, I mean, I think the American people did not give them enough credit. They saw through it, and they voted for, you know, people who believed in democracy and the rule of law. So I think it was a really good night for Democrats, but more importantly, a good night for democracy.
Ben, you know, although Democrats like Mandela Barnes wasn't able to beat out the incumbent Republican Senator Ron Johnson, you did reelect the governor, Tony Evers. What do you think voters did in splitting their tickets? I mean, why do you think that happened in a place like Wisconsin?
So the striking context here is that Wisconsin almost always goes against the party of the president in a midterm. The last time Wisconsin voted for a governor of the same party as the president was 30 years ago. And the last time it was a Democrat was in 1962. 1962 was also the last year when an incumbent Republican in the Senate was defeated during a Democratic presidency. So the fact that we came within 1 point is a testament to Mandela Barnes's strength. And the fact that Governor Evers won a 3.4 percentage point victory, that's triple his 2018 margin during the blue wave year. It's an extraordinary thing. The other piece of this is that Republicans have gerrymandered Wisconsin so badly that they could very well have gotten supermajorities in both chambers of the state legislature. They were 2,499 votes short, but voters said no to having a unilateral Republican control go to a party that didn't even win statewide in the governor's race. So it really is, as Molly was saying, an extraordinary night in a midterm election. It goes against the pattern of history, and it represents a triumph for democracy and for freedom in a moment when a basic freedom was being taken away from half the population.
Ben, I'm so glad you provided that context, Molly, because as Ben was just saying there, when you see it, you know, we kind of sometimes just look at the W's and the L's and we think of only about it in that. But having that context really shows us what the message that was behind all these votes. How critical are these now Democratic blue wall victories ahead of 2024? When you look at the momentum that the Democrats can build on, if you take something that Ben just said with Mandela Barnes and with the Democrats were able to do in a very gerrymandered Wisconsin, how do they reinforce or shore up that blue wall in Pennsylvania and Michigan and in Wisconsin ahead of 2024?
Well, the state houses are really critical, and I think Democrats have sort of gotten interested in them again. Remember, because there was a period during Obama when they, you know, Democrats sort of took their eye off the ball with the state houses, and they've become very committed to working on the state parties. I mean, just like what's happened in Wisconsin, which is really, really great. And when Democrats do that, I think, you know, it helps the up party, you know, the different candidates on the ballot. I would say that the hope is that next time Republicans won't try to dismantle democracy in 2024. I mean, what they did this time was really rebuked by voters. But, you know, and it's very scary to have just one party that believes in the central tenet of our entire governmental system. So I think that the hope is that Republicans will, you know, not do this again. But I think there's a good framework here for Democrats to be able to protect our freedom.
Ben, you mentioned the fact that Democratic voters were able to prevent the GOP from reaching a veto-proof supermajority. I just talked about the significance of what state legislators will be doing if this decision, Harper versus Moore at the Supreme Court, goes the way that perhaps some would like it. Do you believe that folks in your state and elsewhere are beginning to understand just how crucial state level elections are to our democracy? I mean, I keep saying this. I was talking about it with Ali Velshi last night. I don't think any of us 4 years ago, 5 years ago, knew a single name of a secretary of state in this country.
Absolutely. This really is a sea change moment for Democrats. And there are so many people, especially local activists, committed Democratic Party members, members of grassroots groups, who've poured themselves into winning state legislative races, Secretary of State's races, attorney generals, governor's races. That work, revitalizing state parties, building grassroots networks that can turn out voters for offices that are far from the national news, that makes all the difference in the times of the greatest peril. What Molly was referring to, we saw Donald Trump go state by state and try to pressure state officials to overturn election results. And in Wisconsin and these other states, there were people running for offices who wanted to do that in 2024. There's a bill in our state legislature that Republicans introduced that would allow statewide elections to be nullified if the margin of victory is less than the number of absentee ballots cast, which is true of the last four presidential elections here. So, four of the last six.
Yeah.
That means that if Republicans got their way, they could throw out the will of the people and basically pull off a legal coup. That path is now closed. Voters have said no. They've rejected that risk.
So speaking of a legal coup, I got to ask you about this, Ben, before we go. And it's, again, something that you brought up, which is the gerrymandering. There was this new piece in Esquire titled "No One Can Pretend That Wisconsin is a Republic." And I just want to note this from Tuesday. You know, the Democratic Party, as you mentioned, they got 51% of the vote statewide in Wisconsin. They have the electoral majority. That only translated to 30% of the state's legislator seats. What do you make of that assessment? I mean, can you say that Wisconsin is a functioning democracy when you have 51% of the will reflected in only 30% of the political power?
So it means there's something fundamentally broken. And I will say that we got up to 35 seats. So we, 34 seats. So we stopped Republicans from getting the supermajority that they wanted. The 35 seats mean that we can sustain the governor's veto. But there's an opportunity for something better. This April 4th in 2023, we have a state Supreme Court race that will determine the majority on our state Supreme Court. If the non-Republican candidate wins that race, it means that we could have a state Supreme Court that strikes down gerrymandered maps based exactly on that argument, that the constitutional requirement is that people's votes count equally. And with that, Wisconsin could become a democracy like Michigan and Minnesota next to us.
It is Monday, the 14th of November of 2022, and you are in West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. I am your chef de cuisine, Justice Putnam. Gunner the English Bulldog is our snoozing sous chef, and our daily special is River City Hash Mondays. That's right, it's Mondays, and how are you? How are you? It looks like we, being the, well, Democratic wing of America, have a, I say right now, a tenable lead in the Senate, control of such, but we still have Manchin and Sinema, okay? So it would be nice if people continue the extreme efforts it's going to take for that shortened window in Georgia to make sure Warnock holds on to a seat. And even then, I have to tell you, we still have Manchin and Sinema. Who knows what they will do? Change parties? I just don't know. Anything is possible. But 51, I got to tell you, is better than 50. Okay. I'm just saying. So, with that stated, we have our work cut out for us still. And I would say we have our work cut out for us for 2024, too. So I guess there's no rest for the wicked. That's what they call us. Yeah. Anyway, I had really, really hoped, and I'm probably now admitting that the hope, the dream, that we would pull off a real miracle and hold the House to, it will not come to four. It looks like, I think, according to Boozy, we're only going to get about 216 now. And part of the problem, now everybody points at New York. Well, that's an obvious one, because look what happened in New York. Everybody else in Republican states gets to have their extreme gerrymanders, but have the New Yorkers get one? Oh, no. And I wouldn't even call it an extreme gerrymander. It was just a regular gerrymander like all the others that were pushed through in those Republican states, where the Supreme Court and others said, oh, no, go right ahead. No problem. New York? Oh, no, I can't have that. Anyway, I would prefer to have neutral redistricting rather than partisan, and you know, we should do it by the census, and that's why they effed up the census. That's why Trump effed it up. Please, no one talks about that anymore. How do you think we get these apportionment numbers? Darn. Which brings me to another point that doesn't really need to be made because we all know it. The people who know the least about how their government works wants to run the government. And then I say, yeah, but no one ever completes a sentence. They want to run the government into the ground. And the least you know about it, or know enough to be able to drive it into the ground, you don't need to know how the engine works. Just, you know, push that button there and go. Back in the day, you had to turn a key. Now it's just push a button. Sometimes you don't even need to push the button. I mean, that's a slight nod to AI technology that can read your eye movements. Did you know that corporations are like actually tracking eye movements? And there's a big question on whether that's ethical. Yeah. Damn right. It's something unethical about that. Jeez. Doesn't anybody take an ethics class anymore? Apparently not. Ethics? What's that? Yeah, well, that's a liberal conspiracy just made up during the 60s. How many times have we heard that before by idiots who, well, you know, they're a little goose-stepping, trumpen-jungen. There they are. Except they existed a bit before Trump. So I don't know. Maybe Nazi Jungen is the proper moniker for them. Could be. Well, we do have a bit of a read for you today, and I thought maybe I would put this out there. I may be going to visit my elderly dad in Southern California a lot sooner than I actually anticipated. I don't like traveling when there's snow in the mountains anymore. And I've been hobbling around, so because of this issue with this arthritis thing, and I need a knee replacement, but I got to kind of wait a little bit. But do I have the ability to be able to drive to Southern California with the way my legs are? I don't know. I have an idea. I could put the old transmission on the governator. That's what we called it, and let it go. And there is a radar distance thing that, you know, keeps me away from cars and all of that. It's almost like self-driving. Don't trust it. But anyway, that would keep me off the accelerator all the time. And that's a big help. But then I thought, well, I could fly, but will they allow me to take crutches on the plane? Or do I have to put them in baggage? The idea of the crutches is to be able to get to my seat. Then what do I do with my crutches when I get to my seat? I just don't know. I mean, I've never used crutches on a plane before, and it seems like it would be a no-go. Yeah. You know, they do deny flights to people because of their health. Oh, well, I think that you might croak on this flight and you're not going. I mean, that can happen because they don't want you croaking on the flight. I mean, time is money and gas is too. Or petrol, whatever it is. Kerosene, is that what they use? Yeah, they want to turn the plane around. Burn up all that gas. And the time involved as well. So, I just don't know. I have to get down there because, well, you know, he's old and he's been having some issues. And probably would be good to go visit him rather than think, oh yeah, Dad's just going to live forever. That's not how it is. So I'll keep you informed. We'll have to turn the station into a robot station for a bit. And then keep our fingers crossed that power doesn't go out. Because I don't know if there's anyone here that can reset the broadcaster. Because unfortunately, if the power goes out, it has to be reset manually. Unfortunately, darn it. We'll try to fix that. But right now, we're inching along on some pretty old machinery here. And because the bills keep going up, sometimes the money doesn't go towards, well, we are able to do maintenance on the machines, but it's time to upgrade to a different machine, and who knows. Anyway, we'll see how that goes, but I'll keep you informed, and it may be pretty soon, too. Okay, what do we have in store for you for a River City Hash Mondays at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy? The Republican engineered shorter voting window that I mentioned earlier could cut turnout in the Georgia runoff, and that's a feature, not a bug. Oh, and of course, at the top, that was a clip about how we Democrats defied midterm expectations, not only in the national races, but also making historic gains in state legislatures. And that's really where it counts anymore. Pretty soon it'll be dog catcher. We're going to have some constitutional sheriff dog catchers. All right. The U.S. Merchant Marine Academy will get its first female superintendent in the 80-year history of the institution. And a tech CEO is spending millions to stop Elon Musk. Good. Let's get it. And that's actually specifically about artificial intelligence, self-driving cars that seem to, I don't know, veer into the center divider and blow up. Yeah, we'd like that to stop. After the break, we move to the chef's table where liberal rights advocate Natasa Pirc Musar won the runoff to become Slovenia's first female head of state. And the United Nations is investigating allegations of misconduct by Egyptian police providing security at this year's International COP27 climate talks. All that and more on West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bon Appétit. Near the bottom of our homepage at netrootsradio.com, to the right of the page is the chat room link, and the chat room is monitored by Kelly Lincoln. Thank you, Kelly. To the left of that chat room link across the page at our homepage at netrootsradio.com, there is the link to our Patreon page. And I know this is a broken record, and I apologize. But if those of you out there who have not done so already could become a recurring Patreon of Netroots Radio, and if you could afford to send us what you might spend on an espresso-type coffee drink in these inflationary times, and I feel compelled to apologize for that as well. But if you could afford to do so once a month, it really does help us pay our bills. And I got to tell you, the bills keep going up. Boy, even when it wasn't inflationary, they were going up. And now they're going up even more because it's inflationary. So anyway, if you could do that, it would really help. And we thank those of you who have been doing so for quite a while now. It really has helped. So thank you. If you would like to follow Netroots Radio on Twitter, while you still can, you can follow us at Netroots Radio, and Tom takes care of that. Thank you, Tom. You can follow me on Twitter while you still can at Justice Putnam, and I'll figure out what to do. I don't know. I've got a Tumblr account, I guess, and the station does. And the station has a few accounts elsewhere. We'll get Tom and Kelly. I guess they're already on it, but we can migrate to another platform. And I don't know. Maybe Mastodon will be the place to go. I just don't know. Anyway, let's hope that something miraculous happens, because that's what's going to take, a miracle. But you can follow me on Twitter at Justice Putnam. I post the show notes and links diary on Daily Co's 10 minutes before showtime. You could follow that right there on all of Daily Co's anyway. But 10 minutes before showtime, the show notes and links diary is posted. And of course, that is where the real reportage can be found. And you can follow the show on Twitter at Cookbook West. Pick up podcasts by way of Spreaker, Stitcher, TuneIn, iHeart, YouTube, iTunes, etc., etc., etc. Yeah. Okay. Let us now tuck into this first offering in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, River City Hash Mondays. I'll get that out. And it is by Jeff Amy from the Associated Press. Georgia Democrat Raphael Warnock's first runoff in 2021 was a titanic 9-week clash to control the Senate that included 3 weeks of early in-person voting and lots of mail ballots. Warnock's victory against Republican Senator Kelly Loeffler and Democrat John Ossoff's tilt against Republican David Perdue ended in two Democratic victories that gave the party control of a 50-50 Senate, thanks to Vice President Kamala Harris's ability to break ties. Yeah. But the December 6th runoff won't be for Senate control this time, with Democrats retaining seats in Arizona and Nevada. Successful re-election bids by Senators Mark Kelly and Catherine Cortez Masto were what Democrats needed to help keep the slimmest of margins in the chamber. Yeah, the slimmest. Okay. Georgia requires a runoff if a candidate does not win a majority in the party primary or in the general election. And neither Warnock nor Walker got to 50%. Under Georgia's 2021 election law, Remember that. Two Democrat, one against the old boy network. What's that? What's, yeah, there's something wrong here. There will be only 4 weeks before the runoff this time, with Thanksgiving in the middle of it. And they're now trying to say, oh, you can't vote on Saturday. What? Many Georgians will be offered only 5 weekdays of early in-person voting beginning on November 28th, and June's primary runoff showed time for mail ballots to be received and returned can be very tight. Those changes could disadvantage Democrats, who tend to push early voting and vote by mail more than Republicans, because the 2021 law makes it harder to apply for a mail ballot. Democrats urge supporters to vote early in person in October. Democratic U.S. Representative Hank Johnson said it will be challenging to reignite the kind of early voting enthusiasm that Democrats displayed ahead of the general, when overall early voting set a new midterm record. The changes could produce lower turnout and maybe a return to the old rules of Georgia runoffs before 2021, when Republicans had clear advantages. No one who wasn't on the rolls before November 8th can register to vote now, and the last day to register was November 7th. Georgia's 159 counties can open early voting sooner than November 28th if they are able, but they can't begin until the state certifies the general election, currently targeted for November 21st, said Deputy Secretary of State Gabriel Sterling. These people up there were not, Ravensburger and Sterling were not saviors, okay, I'm just saying. Okay, they're the old boys. Only 10 counties offered more than the mandated 5 days during the June primary runoffs, the first statewide elections held with a shortened runoff period. Moreover, state law bars early in-person voting on a state holiday or the Saturday after a state holiday because both Thanksgiving and the following Friday are state holidays. There will be no Saturday voting offered before the runoff. Associated Press brings us this next offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. The U.S. Merchant Marines Academy's next superintendent will be the first woman appointed to the position in the institution's nearly 80-year history, the U.S. Transportation Department announced. Retired U.S. Coast Guard Rear Admiral Joanna Noonan will take the helm at the 1,000-person academy on New York's Long Island in a few weeks, the department said. She succeeds Jack Buono, who resigned in June. Transportation Secretary Pete Buttigieg said Noonan is the right leader at the right time for the Merchant Marine Academy, which has been racked by sexual misconduct allegations in recent years. Her years of experience as a senior military leader, including command at sea, have prepared Rear Admiral Noonan to shape the future of the academy and help ensure the safety and success of its extraordinary midshipmen, Buttigieg said. Last year, the Academy suspended its Sea Year program, which sends cadets to work on container ships, oil tankers, passenger liners, and other vessels for the second time since 2016, after a cadet said a cargo ship supervisor got her drunk and raped her. In December of 2020, the Transportation Department agreed to pay $1.4 million to settle a lawsuit brought by a cadet who alleged he was hazed and sexually assaulted by his academy soccer teammates. Noonan, A Bridgeport, Connecticut native retired this year as the Coast Guard's deputy for personnel readiness. She graduated from the Coast Guard Academy in New London, Connecticut in 1987. She has an MBA from Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute and 3 Coast Guard Merchant Mariner licenses. Noonan spent 9 years at sea, commanded 2 buoy tenders, and was the commander of the 9th Coast Guard District on the Great Lakes and Coast Guard Sector Honolulu. She served as military advisor to Homeland Secretary Jay Johnson and military assistant to Transportation Secretary Norman Mineta, and was later the Coast Guard's assistant commandant for human resources. As the Coast Guard's deputy for personnel readiness, Noonan supervised the Coast Guard Academy and served on its board of trustees. She has also been a member of the Coast Guard's Sexual Assault Prevention, Response, and Recovery Committee. The Merchant Marine Academy trains cadets to work in the commercial shipping industry. It is one of 5 military service academies and the only one under the direction of the Department of Transportation. Garrett DeVint of the Washington Post brings us this final offering here in the Bistro Cafe of West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy River City Hash Mondays. When Dan O'Dowd had his midlife crisis, he bought 2 near-identical Tesla Roadsters, the first model the electric car maker ever produced. This year, the 66-year-old tech entrepreneur added another to his collection, a Model 3 equipped with full self-driving beta, a software program that allows a car to drive on its own on highways and busy city streets. The third Tesla is crucial for an unusual hobby. O'Dowd is waging a multi-million-dollar campaign to get Tesla's full self-driving software off the roads before Tesla CEO Elon Musk follows through with plans to make the tech available worldwide by the end of the year. O'Dowd, who made his fortune selling software to military customers, has been using the Model 3 to test and film the self-driving software. He's documented what appear to be examples of the car swerving across the center line toward oncoming traffic, failing to slow down in a school zone, and missing stop signs. This summer, he triggered an uproar by releasing a video showing his Tesla, allegedly in full self-driving mode, mowing down child-sized mannequins. Don't do it to the dolls! If Tesla gets away with this and ships this product, I can't convince the public that a self-driving car that drives like a drunken, suicidal 13-year-old shouldn't be on the road. I'm going to fail, O'Dowd said in an interview from his Santa Barbara office, where glass cases display his collection of ancient coins and auction-bought mementos from NASA moon missions. O'Dowd has run nationwide TV ads with the videos and even launched an unsuccessful campaign for the U.S. Senate as part of his one-man crusade to challenge what he sees as the cavalier development of dangerous technology. For O'Dowd and other skeptics, the program is a deadly experiment foisted on an unsuspecting public, a view underscored by a recently filed class action lawsuit and a reported Department of Justice investigation into the tech. Despite O'Dowd's high-profile campaign and the concern from some regulators and politicians, Tesla is charging ahead with what it claims is world-changing technology. The company and its supporters argue their approach will help usher in a future in which death from human errors on roadways is eliminated. Oh, good. Let's substitute it with machine errors instead. At the end of September, during a four-hour event in which Tesla showed off its latest artificial intelligence tech, Musk said, "Full self-driving is already saving lives, and keeping it off public roads would be morally wrong." At the point at which you believe that adding autonomy reduces injury and death, I think you have a moral obligation to deploy it, even though you're going to get sued and blamed by a lot of people, Musk said. Musk and Tesla, which does not typically answer media inquiries, did not respond to requests for comment. Readying full self-driving for worldwide deployment by the end of next month adds to Musk's heavy workload. On top of running Tesla and his other companies, SpaceX and Neuralink, he now owns and runs Twitter. Musk has also roped in Tesla engineers to help work on Twitter. I guess that means driving them into the ground. All right, let us now go to our break. And you can finish the rest of that article at the show notes and links, diary. The links are there, and you can get right to this Washington Post article. I believe that you can read it. I have a subscription. I think I can share it with you. Try it. Let me know. If not, we'll figure another way of getting it to you. All right, let us get to our break, and when we get back from that break, we will go through weather from around the world, and we will finish up with the stories that we have curated for you today. You are listening to West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, and we will be right back.
You are listening to NetRootsRadio.com.
Please hang up and try again.
From a point at sea to the circles of your mind, a new force is at work for planetary transformation. New radio for a new earth.
This is Take Two Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. This week, Privilege. There's plenty about that in the more usual sense in James Gray's latest, Armageddon Time, which I'll get to, but consider for a moment director's privilege. There's no rule saying that important directors' early lives are necessarily more interesting than those of the rest of us, but they sure get made into movies more often. The respect we have for these folks stems from their ability to weave a story, so what could be more bankable, literally, in Hollywood than a successful director doing his or her own coming-of-age story? Think Lady Bird, last year's Saccharine Belfast, or Licorice Pizza, though that was based on the story of an industry friend of a big director. Armageddon Time is a several-month slice of the life of New York Jewish-American sixth grader, stand-in Paul Graff, growing up in the just pre-Reagan era. In fact, the movie takes its name from a dumb comment made in an interview with Reagan and is suffused start to finish with snippets of the Clash's cover of Armageddon Time. Paul lives with the aspirational dreams of his family, which he does not share, before he's jerked out of public school for hijinks undertaken with an African-American friend, Johnny, and sent to a private school, which sports as two of its funders, Fred and Marianne Trump, who actually speak, as if their presence doesn't say it all. Paul's parents despise Reagan and, despite being fine-tuned to anti-Semitism, are pretty racist themselves, though Paul's dad seems vaguely troubled by an incident starkly portraying what we'd now call white privilege involving his son and the black friend. The cast, including Jeremy Strong, Anne Hathaway, Anthony Hopkins, and especially young Banks Rapetta, lately of The Black Phone, keep Armageddon Time real, even gritty sometimes, and though it flirts with heavy-handedness in his politics, doesn't drown in them. This has been Take Two Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. Catch up with us at Take2MovieReview.com and feed us back on our channel on YouTube.
This is 60 Second Science. I'm Talika Bose. Iranians have been fiercely and relentlessly protesting against their government. This was sparked by the death of a 22-year-old Kurdish woman named Mahsa Amini, who died in the custody of the country's morality police. The demonstrations have been led by young women who refuse to accept restrictive laws like hijab requirements. But authorities have been cracking down with violence, arrests, and with surveillance. I'm here with Sophie Bushwick, our tech editor at Scientific American. Sophie interviewed Amir Rashidi, who is the director of digital rights and security at Mian Group, an Austin, Texas-based advocacy organization working to improve human rights in Iran. Hey, Sophie.
Hi.
Sophie, so how did you find the story?
I had heard that some protesters in Iran were worried about the government using facial recognition, and I reached out to Amir to just ask him about this technology in particular. But what I learned is that the use of technology for suppression in Iran goes way beyond facial recognition. And in fact, the government is actively trying to create its own nationwide intranet that would be separate from the global internet and allow it to maintain much stricter control over what its citizens can see on the internet.
Do you think that has any ramifications in the near future?
So within Iran, what I learned is that the government has been interested in this intranet project for a while, but there hasn't been a lot of adoption, in part because people know that the government is really interested in surveillance and censorship. It's not just a matter of creating their own servers. They need their own data centers, and they need their own proprietary apps. They've shut down access to WhatsApp. They don't want people to be communicating with the outside world or to have access to that kind of information. So what they've instead suggested is they're trying to push citizens to adopt nationwide apps and the nationwide intranet. They've done things like making the nationwide intranet cheaper and faster than accessing the global internet.
Is Iran taking a page out of anyone else's playbook here?
Yes, there are a lot of authoritarian governments that are very interested in the use of technology for surveillance and censorship. In particular, Iran has a technology sharing agreement with China. There's a category of apps called super apps. So an example is WeChat, which is a Chinese app where you can, you know, stream your favorite videos, you can buy tickets, you can chat, you can browse the internet. It's one app that sort of encompasses the whole world of apps that smaller apps might focus on. And there are apps in Iran that are attempting to do the same thing. So the problem with this is that if you, for example, get kicked off of that app, you lose access to your life. Another thing is that if that app is controlled by the government or by a tech company that is willing to do whatever the government says, then they can have very quick access to everything that you're doing online. The concept of having a countrywide intranet instead of using the global internet is not exclusive to Iran either. Russia announced that they wanted to do this, although they haven't actually implemented it on a completely closed basis. It's becoming clear that multiple authoritarian countries want to have their own little islands of internet that would be separate from the global internet.
That sounds pretty terrifying.
It's not great. It's not great for people who live in the countries that are controlled by the government. It's not great for people who believe in the concept of the internet as a unifying source where people from all over the world can connect with each other and read about what each other are doing.
Aside from being shut off from like the global internet, what else could happen?
Recent reporting actually suggests one of the ways that the government might be throttling connectivity speeds, at least for cell phone users, and that's a computer tool called SIAM. Telecommunications companies install it, and it basically gives the government the ability to target internet speeds on individuals' phones. It's even scarier than that. It has other surveillance access to phones, so it could track a phone's location. It might be able to decrypt messages and other information. And in general, it seems like a surveillance tool that telecommunications companies are just handing over to the Iranian government.
What do you think the biggest takeaway is from this story, and what should people know going forward?
Governments that want to control their citizens are learning from each other, but internet freedom activists are also learning from each other, and advocates all over the world are trying to help Iranians. They're trying to increase access to the internet, and that they are also learning from each other. And I think one of the things that illustrates is the value of the global internet, the way it allows people from all over the world to connect on a common cause.
Thanks for listening to 60 Second Science. I'm Jaleka Bose.
This program is presented by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
Arthritis is common among veterans. Traumatic and overuse injuries during active duty are risk factors for developing arthritis. Fortunately, there are low-cost or no-cost strategies that can help veterans manage arthritis. Physical activity can reduce pain and improve function. It can also help improve mood and play a role in managing other chronic conditions, such as heart disease, diabetes, and obesity. You can do low-impact activities, such as walking, biking, swimming, and water aerobics, all good forms of exercise. Arthritis-specific classes can help you get started. Information on classes, exercise programs, and tools are available at cdc.gov/arthritis. These resources can help reduce pain and improve function. Learning self-management techniques can help all veterans become more active, improve their overall quality of life, and thrive.
For the most accurate health information, visit cdc.gov or call 1-800-CDC-INFO.
This program is presented by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
As fall turns to winter, the flu season will be upon us in force. The best way to avoid influenza is to get immunized. Everyone 6 months and older should be vaccinated. Those at increased risk for flu complications include children under the age of 5 and adults 65 and older, people with chronic health problems such as heart disease, asthma, and diabetes, and pregnant women. To get your annual flu vaccine, see your healthcare provider or go to a pharmacy, grocery store, or clinic in your area. If you get influenza, talk with your healthcare provider right away about antiviral medication. Thank you for joining us on A Minute of Health with CDC.
For the most accurate health information, visit www.cdc.gov or call 1-800-CDC-INFO.
Hi, I'm Tom Hartman, and since you're listening to NetRootsRadio.com, show your progressive side and go to the donate button on the bottom of the homepage. It's progressives like you who power Netroots Radio and keep the progressive message beaming everywhere 24 hours a day. Just go to our donate button at the bottom of netrootsradio.com. Thank you for keeping progressive radio at full power.
What hit the Republican Party on Election Day was, well, the Republican Party. Blow number one, of course, was from the party's president and cult boss, Donald Trump, who wields his narcissism like a political bludgeon. But then, Republicans got an even more damaging gut punch from the party's own Supreme Court majority of six partisan hacks. They chose this election year to assert their personal ideological view that the government should control every woman's birth decisions. Not popular. Then, like a karate chop to the party's own neck, its congressional leaders let loose with a pre-election announcement that, if put in charge, the grand old party would go after people's Social Security and Medicare benefits. But Republicans also got hit with something beyond their control. A bevy of new, unabashedly progressive Democratic candidates running on real populist issues that matter to workaday people, backed up by legions of energized grassroots activists. Candidates like Summer Lee, who will be the first black woman elected to Congress from Pennsylvania, championed by Working Families Party, Our Revolution, and other little-d Democratic groups, she beat back concerted attempts by corporate powers in both major parties that tried to demonize and defeat her, including a last-minute dump of $1 million into her GOP opponent's campaign by the American-Israeli Super PAC. Another is Lena Hidalgo, the feisty people's advocate who is the top county official in Houston, Texas. She faced down a pack of ultra-rich oil magnates, developers, and other corporate interests who put up $9 million in a failed effort to boot her. This is Jim Hightower saying grassroots progressives showed in this election a promising path to democratic rejuvenation. Run aggressive campaigns offering real change from the business-as-usual politics of both parties.
If you'd like more of Jim Hightower's real populism, check out the Hightower Lowdown. Jim's monthly newsletter gives you the real lowdown on which corporations, by name, are doing what to the middle class, our environment, and our democracy. Each month, the Hightower Lowdown brings you facts you didn't know, along with actions you can take to fight back. It also comes with a sense of humor. Hightower believes we can fight the gods and still have fun. Plus, get this, it's cheap. Only $15 brings you 12 issues a year. For real populism, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
I'm Rick Smith, and this is Labor History in 2. On this day in labor history, the year was 1903. Working women from around the nation founded the National Women's Trade Union League in Boston. The organization's founders included female reformers, working class women, as well as women from wealthy families. The purpose of the organization was to assist in the organization of women wage workers into trade unions and thereby to help them secure conditions necessary for healthful and efficient work and to obtain a just reward for such work. One of the inspirations for the Women's Trade Union League was the work of Settlement House organizer Jane Addams. The Women's Trade Union League recognized that women across economic classes were united by what they called the bonds of womanhood. Wealthy league members donated money to the cause. They often served as spokeswomen and arranged for legal representation for workers when necessary. When the league was founded, the trade union movement was male-dominated. The male trade unionists worried more women in the labor market would drive down men's wages. Often, union leaders were unwilling to allow women into their ranks. The Women's Trade Union League was one of the primary organizers of female garment workers, particularly in New York City and Chicago. The League was a key supporter of the 1909 New York City shirtwaist workers' strike, also known as the Uprising of 20,000. The League was also a vocal advocate for the women's suffrage movement. The Women's Trade Union League disbanded in 1950, and in 1974, the Coalition of Labor Union Women was founded in Chicago to continue the fight to ensure women have a voice in the labor movement. However, women workers still earn about 80 cents on the dollar compared with men. The work of the Women's Trade Union League remains unfinished. Like what you hear? Check out more at laborhistoryin2.com.
Thank you for accompanying us here to the chef's table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy River City Hash Mondays. We always begin weather from around the world along the banks of the Rogue River in the Rogue River Valley of Southern Oregon on the west coast of the continental United States of America, where it is currently 33 degrees Fahrenheit under foggy conditions and a air stagnation advisory for the region. Looks like we'll have some clouds this morning, giving way to generally sunny skies for the afternoon. Highs around the mid-50s, which is a bit warmer than what we've had. Winds light and variable. Clear skies overnight with lows around 30. Winds light and variable. And then mainly sunny skies tomorrow with highs in the upper 50s, which is considerably warmer, and winds will remain light and variable. Pollen is rated as none here in Rogue River proper. The air quality index for the region is in the moderate range at 60 parts per million, part of that air stagnation phenomena. And the daytime UV index is low at level 2. Barometric pressure is holding steady at 30.28 inches. Visibility is down to a half mile, and relative humidity is at 91%. Weather from around the world is brought to you by a crowd of crowdsourced weather stations that a crowd crowdsources from around the world. London is 55 degrees and partly cloudy. Paris is 55 and cloudy. Rome is 61 degrees and fair. Kyiv is 41 and partly cloudy. Kabul is 38 and clear. Hong Kong is 75 and fair. Tokyo is 58 degrees with showers in the vicinity. Sydney, Australia is 65 and clear. San Francisco, California is 44 degrees and sunny. And New York, New York is 42 degrees Fahrenheit and fair. And that is weather from around the world, brought to you by a crowd of crowdsourced weather stations that a crowd crowdsources from around the world. Dusan Stojanovic of the Associated Press brings us this first amuse-bouche here at the Chef's Table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy, River City Hash Mondays. Liberal rights advocate Natasa Pirc Musar won a runoff yesterday, Sunday, to become Slovenia's first female head of state and said she will seek to bridge the deep left-right divide in the Alpine nation of 2 million people. With nearly all of the votes counted in the small European Union nation, Pirc Musar led Slovenia's conservative former foreign minister Anže Logar by 54-46%. Her victory boosts the country's liberal bloc following the center-left coalition victory in Slovenia's parliamentary election in April. My first task will be to open a dialogue among all Slovenians, she said, as her election team celebrated. In the democratic election, Slovenians have shown what kind of a country they want. All my life, I've advocated the same values: democracy, human rights, tolerance. It's time to stop dealing with the past. Many things have to be done in the future, she declared. Logar conceded defeat, saying he hopes Pirc Musar will carry out all the promises that she made during the campaign. Pirc Musar, age 54, will be the first woman to serve as president since Slovenia became independent amid the breakup of Yugoslavia in 1991. A prominent lawyer, Pirc Musar had represented former U.S. First Lady Melania Trump in copyright and other cases in her native Slovenia. She trailed Logar in the first round of voting 2 weeks ago, but since none of the seven contenders who competed in the first round managed to gather more than 50% support to claim outright victory, Logar and Pirc Musar went to a runoff. Analysts in Slovenia had predicted that centrist and liberal voters would rally behind Pirc Musar.
Je te donne seulement l'amour pour la vie entière. La promesse de me trouver à tes genoux. Aussitôt que tu m'appelles, rester toujours fidèle. C'est tout, c'est tout. Je te donne tous mes printemps, mes étés de mai. Mes automnes, quand les feuilles tombent partout. Si ce n'est pas une bonne affaire, je te donne tous mes hivers.
Associated Press staff bring us this final amuse-bouche here at the Chef's Table at West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy River City Hash Mondays. The United Nations says it is investigating allegations of misconduct by Egyptian police officers providing security at this year's international climate talks. This follows claims that attendees of events at the German pavilion for the COP27 summit were photographed and filmed after Germany hosted an event there with the sister of a jailed Egyptian pro-democracy activist, Ala Abdel Fattah, who also holds UK citizenship. In a statement provided to the AP, the UN Climate Office confirmed that some of the security officers working in the part of the venue designated as United Nations territory came from the host country, Egypt. The security officers provided for this COP by the host country are from the National Police, it said. They are here to assist in fortifying the venue and ensuring the safety and security of all participants. Germany's foreign ministry said that it was in contact with Egyptian authorities about the incidents at its pavilion. We expect all participants in the UN Climate Conference to be able to work and negotiate under safe conditions, it said in a statement. This is not just true for the German, but for all delegations, as well as representatives of civil society and the media. Well, that brings us to the end of our broadcast period for the day. But you do know Netroots Radio broadcasts on, and we will meet up here tomorrow for Tarrytown Chowder Tuesdays. So do stay tuned to Netroots Radio all day and all night for all the breaking news as it breaks. And we will meet up here tomorrow, right here, in West Coast Cookbook and Speakeasy. Bon appétit.
Je voudrais du soleil vert, des dentelles et des théières, des photos de bord de mer, d'un mangeadin d'hiver. Je voudrais de la lumière, comme en Nouvelle-Angleterre. Je veux changer d'atmosphère, d'un mangeadin d'hiver. Je voudrais du Fred Astaire, revoir un latte cohère. Je voudrais toujours te plaire dans mon jardin d'hiver. Je veux déjeuner par terre comme au long de golfe clair, t'embrasser les yeux ouverts dans mon jardin d'hiver. Dans mon jardin d'hiver.